from Corolla to Ocracoke. News and events, sports and fishing, and special features. This is The Outer Banks with Ken Mann.
Good evening and welcome to our first program. In the news this evening, Dare County law enforcement officers, the Kill Devil Hills Police Department, and the State Bureau of Investigation brought a new drug interdiction program to Dare County recently. A fire at the Ramada Inn in Kill Devil Hills reminds us that it's important to be prepared for emergencies, not just when we're at home, but also when we're traveling. And a local real estate developer and member of the state's Coastal Resources Commission has been accused of conflict of interest. We'll have the details on these and other stories, as well as taking a look at fishing, and we'll spend a few minutes with Dare County's manager, Terry Wheeler. The Dare County Sheriff's Office, the Kill Devil Hills Police Department, and the State Bureau of Investigation brought a new drug prevention program to northeastern North Carolina recently to help stop the flow of drugs to the Outer Banks. The effort resulted in 41 arrests on 53 drug, littering, and revoked license charges. The officers set up a drug checkpoint near East Lake, similar to a license check. Officers put up signs warning motorists that they were approaching the drug checkpoint. Other officers in unmarked cars positioned ahead of the checkpoint stopped vehicles when the occupants attempted to throw out drugs or turned around before reaching the checkpoint. In addition to the drugs, officers also confiscated illegal fireworks and alcohol. The most serious charge was one felony possession of cocaine with intent to sell or deliver. Mark A. Brooks of Miller Creek was charged with the cocaine felony when about 1.5 grams were found in his vehicle. His 1989 Dodge four-wheel drive pickup truck was confiscated along with $278 in cash. Every fifth vehicle was stopped, and they were only searched when given permission by the driver or when the officers found probable cause that drugs may be present. A few motorists complained about being stopped, that it was inconvenient, but most were very supportive of the officers' work. The Currituck County Commissioners have voted 3-2 to accept their new budget for the 1992-93 year. The new Currituck County budget calls for a 2% increase in the general operating fund, 7% increase in school operations, and they gave each of the Currituck County employees a $600 per year raise. Dare County has also accepted its budget for the new year, and again we'll spend a few minutes with Terry Wheeler a little later in the program to talk about the Dare County budget. Fire departments from Nags Head, Kill Devil Hills, Kitty Hawk, Collington, and Roanoke Island responded to a call at the Ramada Inn in Kill Devil Hills. The fire resulted in little damage, but all of the guests of the motel had to be evacuated. A fire of this nature reminds us how important it is to be prepared for emergencies, not just when we're at home, but also when we're traveling. This is Assistant Kill Devil Hills Fire Chief Craig Clark.
The use of 911 in the early reporting of fires can be significant in reducing damage from fire, preventing injuries or possibly deaths from them. It's important for all our residents and all our guests to know their house address, the street they're on, and the city they're on so that they can make a quick identification and our 911 central can dispatch the proper units quickly and efficiently to the scene of their fire.
As a part of our program each week, we'd like to take a look back at the history of the Outer Banks. We're going to do this by showing you some old photographs courtesy of the Outer Banks History Center. We're going to do our very best to identify them, where they took place, and at approximately what time they were taken. This first photo is a picture of Old Nag's Head. The picture was taken just south of Jockey's Ridge. We believe it was taken somewhere around 1915. It shows vacationers arriving to spend a few days at the beach. We'll be back with more news in a moment.
Seafood prepared the Etheridge way. That's what the Etheridge Seafood Restaurant is all about. Recipes handed down from one generation of Etheridges to another. Seafood fried or broiled, blackened dishes prepared and served in a variety of ways. And new from the Etheridge menu is seafood pizza, served with red or white sauce. And from the Irene Etheridge cookbook, seafood egg rolls that are an award-winning recipe. The Etheridge Seafood Restaurant, milepost 9.5 on the bypass in Kill Devil Hills. Fresh seafood prepared the Etheridge way.
Nag's Head Hammocks, milepost 9.5 on the bypass in Kill Devil Hills and milepost 10.5 on the beach road at Nag's Head has handcrafted woven hammocks and leisure furniture made on the premises. Nag's Head Hammocks has that unique gift or that special accent of leisure furniture for your beach cottage or home. With shipping of any product, Nag's Head Hammocks assures you of quality, durability, and workmanship of all their products. Nag's Head Hammocks, milepost 9.5 on the bypass in Kill Devil Hills and milepost 10.5 on the beach road in Nag's Head.
The Daniels family has been in the seafood business long enough to know what fresh means. At Fisherman's Wharf, they specialize in generous portions of the freshest seafood available, prepared to your liking. Enjoy the view of Wanchese Harbor, and on occasion, watch the boats unload their catch. But by all means, before you leave, stop by Cap'n Malk's Seafood Market and take some fresh seafood home for later. Fisherman's Wharf, home of good folks and great food.
The Duck Pottery has come to Duck. Kellogg's in Duck has great gift ideas for home and garden. It's a new shop filled with gift ideas from far and wide. Kellogg's Duck Pottery is a collection of the novel, the unique, and the natural. Pottery, yardware, windmills, baskets, buckets, and woodcrafts priced right for the smart shopper. Whoever thought you'd find shopping like this? Kellogg's did, and they're bringing it to you. The Duck Pottery, located at Kellogg's in beautiful downtown Duck.
Why do so many people come back to eat at the Dunes restaurant? Maybe it has something to do with the great food, priced so that you can afford to take the whole family. The Dunes has a breakfast bar, lunch, and dinner specials, early bird dinner specials, and a fantastic salad bar. So bring the whole family to the Dunes. It's a local favorite. Oh yeah, don't forget your hat and t-shirt from the Dunes restaurant too. The Dunes, milepost 16.5, Nag's Head.
The first report of an animal with canine distemper in Nag's Head came in this week. It was a gray fox seen around the 2500 block near Wrightsville Avenue in Nag's Head. There have been 25 other reports over the past 45 days, but all of them have been on the northern beach around Southern Shores, Duck, and in Kitty Hawk. A lot of people think that when they see these animals they have rabies, but that's not the case. Most of them have distemper and it appears as though they're intoxicated. They stagger around. You're advised not to touch them or try to feed them. There's no threat to human life, but your dogs should have their proper shots. If you see an animal that has a problem, the Wildlife Commission has a wildlife problem and violations number that you can call. It's 1-800-662-7137. The November general election is getting closer every day. Locally, one out of two men seeking to run as an unaffiliated candidate for the Dare County Board of Commissioners have qualified. Hiram Gallup of Wanchese and Brant Wise needed 533 names each on a petition to run for office. Gallup turned in 661 names, of which 584 were qualified voters in Dare County. Wise turned in 580 names, but only 457 were qualified to sign his petition. Gallup will face Clarence Skinner and Sonny Ambrose in the November election. The annual Wanchese Seafood Festival has grown and it's changed over the years. We were at this year's festival and we had an opportunity to speak with the festival chairman, Rich Novak.
The festival, Wanchese Seafood Festival, started roughly 10 years ago. As a matter of fact, this was our 10th anniversary. And the purpose of it was to publicize the need for jetties at Oregon Inlet. They were passed in the early 70s by Congress, and we've had a problem getting them approved and in place because of the Park Service and a number of other roadblocks that have come through, funding and so forth. And so the Wanchese Seafood Festival was a good opportunity to bring a group of people together that might have some influence somewhere down the line, anywhere we could find someone to talk to. We've been talking to them. So we set up displays. Well, it's changed into a very social event. Everybody enjoys coming down on the waterfront, seeing the boats, the commercial fishing. We bring in the commercial fishing boats and just have a good time.
Novak estimated that 6,000 to 8,000 people attended this year's festival. Before we go into our next commercial break, we'd like to show you another old photograph from the Outer Banks. This is a picture of the G.A. Kohler from Baltimore, Maryland. She came ashore on Hatteras Island. August the 23rd, 1933, was a beautiful four-masted sailing ship. It laid on the beach there for a number of years. We believe that it was finally destroyed during World War II. When we come back, we'll look at some fishing photos. Stay with us.
In the 1920s, the Midgets began their seafood business and have continued through four generations. At Midget Seafood Restaurant, you'll find a selection of delectable and skillfully prepared seafood and steaks. They take great pride in their food preparation using age-old family recipes. Your hosts, Jeffrey Gray Midget and his son Jeffrey Wade, know that using only the freshest seafood available combined with good service keeps their customers coming back time and again. Midget Seafood Restaurant, upholding a 75-year tradition.
At Newman's Seashell and Gift Shop, milepost 13 and a half on the beach road in Nag's Head, you can discover one of Nag's Head's oldest and finest traditions in shopping. Their collection of native and exotic seashells has grown into the largest exhibit on the Outer Banks. Newman's offers thousands of seashells, plus locally made gifts, jewelry, and unique souvenirs. Take time to experience what has attracted generations of beachgoers. Lots of seashells at low prices. At Newman's Seashell and Gift Shop, milepost 13 and a half, Nag's Head.
This is Carl and Zena Hazer. You know the Hazers. They've invited everybody to see their new business, Nag's Head Florist. Carl and Zena arrange and deliver to their customers the freshest flowers available. With years of floral experience, they know what good service and quality products mean to their customers. So for that special occasion or a spur-of-the-moment flower that says, I'm sorry or I love you, call Nag's Head Florist, 441-4861. Make Nag's Head Florist your florist of choice on the Outer Banks.
Why pay more for your furniture, appliances, carpeting, and accessories elsewhere when for 45 years, Mattio Furniture has built a reputation of trust that you can depend on? With 8 showrooms and 48,000 square feet, Mattio Furniture has the largest inventory in northeastern North Carolina of quality Broyhill, Bassett, and Henry Link furniture, GE and RCA appliances, and bedding by Kingsdown and Serta. Mattio Furniture also offers in-store financing and a complete service department. So shop and save from people you know and trust at Mattio Furniture.
You'll not find any better food or atmosphere than at the Pier House Restaurant, located on the Nag's Head Fishing Pier at milepost 12. The Pier House Restaurant opens at 6 a.m. with an affordable breakfast for the early riser. And for lunch, the Pier House Restaurant offers both a hot or cold lunch special. For dinner, enjoy ordering from their dinner menu or one of their all-you-can-eat seafood specials. The Nag's Head Pier House Restaurant, milepost 12. Ocean View Dining, morning, noon, or night.
This is a part of the program that I really enjoy, sports and fishing. Did you know that the Outer Banks has a semi-pro baseball team? They're called the Sun Rays. The team's headed up by Leon Daniels, and they'll be playing three home games this coming weekend. On Saturday, July the 11th at 5 p.m., they'll take on Deep Creek from Virginia at the Mattio High School field. And then on Sunday, July the 12th at 3 p.m., they'll be playing the Deltaville Deltas. The starting pitcher for the Deltas is a man you might remember. His name is Keith Atherton. He played 8 years in the major leagues. He played with the Oakland A's, and he was on the 1987 Minnesota Twins World Champion baseball team. Keith pitched against the Sun Rays in Deltaville. Deltaville won 7-4. So the Sun Rays are hoping that the home field advantage will enable them to win on Sunday. Saturday's game is a doubleheader. Sunday's game will be just one nine-inning game. They certainly hope that you'll plan to come out and attend. We plan to have more sports stories for you in future programs. Now let's take a look at fishing. Fishing on the Outer Banks has been pretty good over the past few days, particularly off the piers, out in the ocean, and back in the sounds. This first picture is of Chris Gilmore fishing on the Nag's Head Pier. He caught a 40-pound, 55-inch king mackerel. Chris is from Chesapeake, Virginia. Here's a picture of a real nice catch of dolphin. It's Sharon Shokoff, Eddie Irwin, Bud Birchfield, and Tim Irwin. Now that should be a familiar name and a familiar face. He's a professional football player. They were fishing on the Hustler with Captain Skip Feller and mate Finn Gatty. Terry McCluskey was fishing on the Outer Banks Pier the last day of June when he caught this 35-pound king mackerel. He was 50 inches long, 23 inches in the girth. He was using a live bluefish rig when he hooked him. Here's some local folks that were fishing with another celebrity. The gentleman that you see second from the right is Bill Berge, who played with the Philadelphia Eagles. That's Jackie Ricks, Eddie Goodrich, Charlie Harris, Richard Tolson, Michael Davenport, and Juna McCarter. They were fishing with Captain V.P. Brinson on board the Fido out of Pirates Cove when they caught these dolphin. For the latest fishing information, we invite you to listen to Carolina 92, WNHW, 92.5 on your FM dial. Here's another old photograph. This one's of the Oregon Inlet Fishing Center, believed to have been taken in the 1950s. When we come back, we'll spend a few minutes with Dare County Manager Terry Wheeler, and we'll talk about the budget.
Fishing Unlimited is five reasons so many people come to the Outer Banks. It's fun for the whole family. It's the freshest seafood anywhere. It's fishing tackle. It's the Outer Banks Pier at milepost 18 and a half in South Nag's Head. And our Roanoke Sound Fishing and Crabbing Pier on the Nag's Head Matio Causeway. Two great piers for one price. There's also a trained staff on hand at both locations to assist you. They do all of that so you'll have all the memories at Fishing Unlimited.
The folks at the Duchess of Dare restaurant invite you to join them for breakfast, lunch, and dinner daily. They feature an all-you-can-eat breakfast buffet on Saturday and Sunday, dinner buffet Tuesday through Saturday, and lunch buffet every Sunday. The Duchess of Dare also has a special children's menu, so mom and dad and the kids can all dine out at an affordable price. Located in historic downtown Mateo on Roanoke Island, enjoy a meal today, breakfast, lunch, or dinner at the Duchess of Dare restaurant.
Village Home Furnishings has the largest inventory of home furnishings on the Outer Banks. Let the professional staff of designers create an interior with brilliant colors of furniture, pictures, window treatments, and accessories for your beach cottage or home. After your choice has been made, let Village Home Furnishings deliver and set up your new furniture. Then all you need to do is show off your new home furnishings from Village Home Furnishings, milepost 11 on the bypass at Nag's Head or milepost 6 on the bypass in Kill Devil Hills.
Let your dream soar at Kitty Hawk Kites. Since 1974, Kitty Hawk Kites has added adventure to the Outer Banks. Kitty Hawk Kites has gifts for everyone, from whimsical to magical to fanciful. The largest selection of kites on the East Coast, with a trained staff to assist you in learning that kiting is a family sport. Famous t-shirt designs. Visit the new Flying Fish Camp, a true outdoor adventure wear store at Kitty Hawk Kites, across from Jockey's Ridge in Nag's Head.
On tonight's program, we're pleased to have with us Terry Wheeler, the Dare County Manager. Terry, thank you for taking a few minutes to be with us.
Thank you, Ken.
I'd like to talk just a few minutes with you about the budget. We know that the budget has been adopted, but the first proposal you brought forth called for a 13% increase in taxes, and now the new proposal, actually the adopted budget, calls for the same tax base as last year, or tax rate as last year. What happened?
I'd like to explain to you a little bit about the process, because I think there's been maybe too much emphasis on what a manager presents as a budget. And one thing I think that people do know and understand is what final approval is given on the budget is what the commissioner's wishes are. And so we have a process that we go through, and department heads submit requests to me, and we do it a little different than most counties do, in that we take the entire budget that is presented by department heads and submit it to the county commissioners for review.
You submit a budget that represents the request of all the departments of the county. At that point, you have not done anything with that budget yourself except compile the total request of all the departments.
That's correct.
And that's what was presented originally.
That's correct. And from that, that budget at the time was some called for some 25% increase in the budget. This was, like I said, was submittals by all department heads. But it gave the opportunity to the county commissioners to see what every department head's needs were and what their requests were. And I think that gives them an opportunity to meet one-on-one with county commissioners. Mm-hmm. It gives them an opportunity to make the commissioners aware of their duties and responsibilities. It also gives them the opportunity at that time of the year, because so many times during the year, commissioners don't have an opportunity to sit down one-on-one with department heads. So commissioners went through 4 days, complete full days of workshops with the department heads on their budgets. And then they gave the budget back to me. And at that time, I worked it for about a month, I guess, working and doing with it what I could. And I submitted to them some things that did call for a 13-cent increase in taxes, which was a 5-cent tax increase. Mm-hmm. But it included some items that, for instance, we have a need for a Health and Human Services building. Commissioners had authorized some funding last year to begin the process of site evaluation, actually do construction and some engineering work on it, some construction documents. And so those things were in the budget and, mm-hmm. and caused part of the 13-cent tax increase. The new jail opening, that is one of the things that had caused a large increase of the 5 cents. That amounted to the jail budget this current year is $400,000. This coming year, it will be over $1.7 million. And that represents 3.8 cents on the tax rate.
What did you do? I guess they sent you back and said, you need to do something with this. What did you do to get that budget so it was in line where we would not have a tax increase in light of the fact that you did have to have some increases? You did have to pay for the operation of the jail this coming year.
Right.
What happened?
Well, one of the things were the Board of Education this year. As you know, they had been carrying a large fund balance. Mm-hmm. And the commissioners had asked the Board of Education to use that fund balance this coming year to help offset the tax rate. That helped us some. We delayed the Health and Human Services building. Part of the presentation that I made to them called for an increase in salaries to county employees, giving them a 5% across-the-board increase. That issue of a 5% increase is $500,000. Mm-hmm. We have approximately 450 county employees. The proposal that was finally adopted by the commissioners, giving all employees a 725% increase, cost about $325,000. So we were able to cut $200,000 there.
And you say a 725% increase or?
$725.
Dollar increase, okay, I understand.
And so those are some of the things that we were able to cut back on to get the tax rate back to where it was this current year.
What happens in the case of the school board, for example, the Board of Education? Will they use some of their fund balance to subsidize their needs then?
Unfortunately, we don't have the ability to make the school board or say what their budget should consist of or what they should approve in their budget. We only allocate them a certain amount of funds. What they use it for and where they put those funds is up to the school board. And the county commissioners really are not involved in that process.
I understand. How about things like youth services? We've heard discussions sure. about what would happen to youth services. And I've heard from you prior to this time together that those things won't change for the coming year. What happened there?
Absolutely not. We have three departments in county government that we felt like there was some duplication of services. That involves youth services, recreation, and the cooperative extension department, which is partially funded by state expenses. All right, so we took those three departments and looked at them. We felt like there were some programs that were being conducted in youth services that we could consolidate with current resources and current staff that we have in the recreation and cooperative extension department. We were able to save every one of the programs, mm-hmm. The governor's one-on-one program, the summer day camp program, the summer day trippers program. Every program in youth services will be continued fully, as had been intended in the coming year's budget. But by that consolidation effort, we were able to cut $72,000 out of the budget.
Well, let's see. Last year, you actually reduced our taxes slightly.
Yes.
This year, we held them the same. What is the future now? Our tax base hasn't increased as it has in the past. In past years in Dare County, because of wonderful real estate development and growth and building, the tax base was increasing steadily. I think you've probably seen those increases at least drop somewhat. What does the future hold for us?
If the economy doesn't get better, it doesn't look any better. We do have some known expenses coming up that we know we cannot avoid. The jail is not just hitting us this year. The increase in the jail this year is just to operate the jail. Mm-hmm. Next year, we will be looking at least 3 cents on the tax rate to pay the debt service, the first year's debt service on the jail. So that is an expense that I know we're facing, and we will have to somehow adjust to that. We also, the commissioners, will be faced with the problem of if the Board of Education uses a large sum from their fund balance to offset their budget this year, that has to come from somewhere next year. Mm-hmm. And we don't know at this point what kind of fund balance they will have for next year. So those are things that that I'm concerned about for next year, and the commissioners are well aware of them, and we'll certainly deal with those things when they come about.
Well, you've got a challenging job in the future. Thank you for spending a few minutes with us and sharing with us a little bit about this year's budget. We'll be back to close out our program in just a few moments.
Northeastern Protection Service has been providing security officers, private investigators, and fire and burglar alarm systems since 1982. They've now expanded their services to include a new retail outlet featuring OSHA-required safety equipment and supplies for police, fire, and rescue personnel and volunteers. Northeastern Protection will beat almost any deal on lights, ammo, and the supplies you need now. Visit their new location across from Midway, Texaco, or call 473-5551. Locally owned, Northeastern Protection, a respected name for a decade.
There is a longing, a hunger that lies deep in each and every one of us. A feeling as old as man himself.
Does that sound like you? You need to have dinner with the Pig Man. Whether it's barbecue tuna, pork, beef, chicken, or rib. Well, the Pig Man's barbecue is where you should be.
Satisfy that hunger. Forever.
Yo, this here's old Ralph from Macon Tracks. It's the 9.5 mile post on the bypass in Kill Devil Hills. Hey, come on down to Macon Tracks where they have the only fully automated 2-minute car wash on the Outer Banks. And while you're there, fill up with Exxon gasoline, and get some ice and your favorite beverages, or try a couple of them world-famous hot dogs fixed just the way you like it. Pick up some suntan oil, sunglasses, or beach accessories. It's all at Macon Tracks. They've got everything to make a great day at the beach. And hey, when you get there, tell them Ralph sent you.
The Manio waterfront is indeed rich in history. Unlike today, commercial fishermen use sailing vessels called Sharpies to ply their trade. Clara's Seafood Grill and Steam Bar is proud of this heritage and is currently having a 20-foot scale model of a Sharpie built for display. Clara's carries a long family tradition of serving only the finest food available, excellently prepared and served, including their new Steam Bar. Awaiting you is a panoramic view of Shalabag Bay and the Elizabeth II. So chart your course for Clara's Seafood Grill.
We'd like to leave you with a little more history from the Outer Banks. This is another old photograph from Nag's Head. It's John Peterson. It was taken back in the early 1900s. He's selling watermelons door to door, or should we say cottage to cottage, from his cart. Thank you for being with us. Have a good evening.